this doctor called Dr. Charles. I called him over and I said, I feel like I'm going to pass out again. And he was looking up at the machine. I was hooked up to wires to a machine there. And he said to me, Joe, your numbers look fine. Rest. And within a matter of seconds, I crashed again. So the doctors knew. It was actually quite odd for them to have a conscious patient telling them that I was going to pass out. So as the doctors did gather around, I remember Dr. Charles saying to all the other nurses and doctors, if Joe tells you that he's going to pass out, believe him, because he'll tell you before the machines do.
This is the Recovery After Stroke podcast with Bill Gassiamis, helping you navigate recovery after stroke.
Bill from recoveryafterstroke.com. This is episode 126, and my guest today is Joe Cassaniti. At the age of 48, Joe, a father of two and a husband, and a fresh pasta manufacturer, experienced a progressive stroke in the pons area of his brainstem. Now, before we get started, if you have ever wondered what else I can do to help you with your stroke recovery, you should know that you can now get recovery after stroke coaching right from the comfort of your own home. I too am a three-time stroke survivor and a brain surgery survivor, and I've built for you what I was missing when I was sent home from hospital, in the hope that you don't have to do stroke recovery as tough as I did. Support packages give you access to a variety of tools 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, so that you can also work on other areas of stroke recovery that you don't get the chance to at physical therapy or rehabilitation. With tailored support available for less than $8.50 per week, all recovery after stroke support packages will bring stroke recovery to you in the comfort of your own home. To try out recovery after stroke support and see if it is right for you, you will get the first 7 days free, as well as a 30-day money-back guarantee, no questions asked. As a bonus, you will also get two face-to-face Zoom support calls with myself to take your recovery to the next level. Go to recoveryafterstroke.com/support to sign up. It won't cost you anything for the first 7 days, and you will get a full refund if you are not happy after 30 days. You have nothing to lose and everything to gain. And now it's on with the show. Joe Cassaniti, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Mate, my pleasure. Tell me, Joe, a little bit about what happened to you.
Let's see. April 15, 2018, my life changed forever. I was at home on a Sunday, and I was with my wife doing some work, as you do, and we were just sitting opposite each other, and she noticed that my speech wasn't the best, and I was struggling myself, and we kind of got to the point at the same time, but we didn't make anything of it. I thought I was just tired because I was making some pasta the day before. So I went and had a rest on the lounge, and woke up again and noticed that I lost my balance. And I then said to Antoinette, there's a problem. Antoinette's my wife, by the way. I said, let's go to the hospital because this is not right, and I'm not feeling the best. So my balance was a problem. My speech was a problem. So we went straight to RPA.
Royal Prince Alfred Hospital in Sydney.
Yeah.
And did you have, up until that day, that Sunday, did you have any signs? Now, looking back, obviously this is the Recovery After Stroke podcast, so I know why you're here. I know that you had a stroke. Was there any signs leading up to that particular day that something wasn't right? Did you feel off at all?
No, I felt okay. So as I mentioned, Saturday I worked. Sunday morning, Antoinette and I were just doing some work on the computer on the dining table. The odd thing was that the stroke wasn't complete. It was only just the start of the problem. There were several other complications which happened later on when I got into hospital.
Okay, so how old were you?
48.
48. So you're in good health mostly. You're running your own business.
Mm-hmm.
It's a pasta business, yeah?
Yeah, we make fresh pasta.
What are your hours like? When before that April day in 2018, what were your hours like?
Well, I was working Monday to Friday. I did do occasional Saturdays. We were in a busy time. So I had to work the Saturday to make some gnocchi. And I went home that afternoon, got it around the house, and the next day is when I feel ill. But it's usually Monday to Friday, 7 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Yep. So what's going on with the rest of your life? Children, family, all that kind of stuff? What's that like?
I'm a dad of three boys. Matthew and Alex are 22 years old, and little Luke is not so little, is 18. I work not far from home, so it's just a walk up the street for me to head to the pasta factory and enjoy life.
Yeah, nice, man. So life is just regular, standard suburban life, a business, kids around the place. Things are generally busy for people like us mostly. There's things to do. There's people to keep happy and there's deadlines to meet and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Are you the kind of guy that was looking after his health? Would you say that in your 48 years up until then, were you the type of guy that was paying attention to your health and well-being?
That would be a big negative. I didn't because, look, time, pressures, being complacent. I was diagnosed as a diabetic when I was 30 and I thought I was invincible. So I wasn't really proactive in looking after my diabetes. My diabetes is a little awkward. It's not exactly type 2 and it's not type 1, but I'm tablet and insulin dependent. So I was being a cheeky boy and not taking my insulin when I was supposed to have. So I ran ridiculous sugar levels. So the stroke was brought on by my carelessness with my health. For me, everything else was going on in my life, my family, my business. So I didn't get much of a chance to look after myself.
What is it with that, Joe? Because you've got time to do all that other stuff, but put a tablet in your mouth and swallow it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have time to do that. What do you think is going on in your head to say, I've got no time for that?
Well, I thought I was invincible. Truly, I thought I was invincible. I never, ever thought that I would have a stroke. I didn't know you could get a stroke from out-of-control diabetes.
Right.
But we learned a little too late.
So that's interesting. So what did you know that could happen about your diabetes? So if left untreated and you weren't on top of it, what were the risks of diabetes? Did you have any idea?
Sight, neuropathy, obviously drinking a lot of water, going a lot to the bathroom. I just wasn't aware that I could put myself at risk of having a stroke, which I did.
So what's neuropathy?
Neuropathy is when you start to lose sensation in your extremities, so your feet, yeah. Your eyes, your hands. So it's just losing sensation in your nerve endings.
Did you ever find that you experienced any of that stuff while you were not taking your medication?
Look, I did. It was mostly my vision, but it fixed itself up after I took insulin. So it wasn't that I wasn't taking my medication. I just wasn't taking it regularly.
How long would you say was the time when you're being slack on it, that you weren't taking it regularly?
Well, there was a time that I was really looking after my health. I headed to the gym. I loved lifting weights. So that kind of kept my sugars at bay. So I was being active physically, and that helps with lowering sugars.
Yeah.
But look, it would go between 2 and 3 months that I'd be on and off, and then I'll be religious back on. And that's not good for your system either. You can't have highs and lows, because that's even more dangerous.
Yeah. Did you find that time when you were religious, was there less busyness going on in your life? Was there less deadlines, less things to achieve? Or did somehow your mindset change that allowed you to be more on your game?
Look, the business was always there, and I was constantly thinking about work. Even at home, I'd be going home wondering what items we needed to make the next day, customers placing large orders. You would have busy days, you would have not so busy days. So the not so busy days, I'd probably pay more attention to my health. I'd be getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning some days. I'd go down to the gym, train a bit, and then head back into work.
Yeah. I know that type 2 diabetes is very much responsive in a positive way to weight-bearing exercises. So even if you're not trying to make muscle or, you know, become Arnold Schwarzenegger, you will get a really good result by converting that energy from sugar into energy to go into the muscles, so the muscles can actually lift the weight, right? So I know that's really good for you. Yeah. And usually with type 2 diabetics, they say change your diet. Now, the science around that is shifting, because previously it was just eat what you're eating and just take your insulin shot. But now we know that the diet is really important. So if you are on a lower carbohydrate diet, that supports keeping blood sugars lower. Now, you're making pasta every day.
That's the point. Actually, this is the point, Bill. When I was first diagnosed as a diabetic, the doctor said to me, you got to watch your carb intakes, your bread, your pastas. I think he forgot that, A, I'm Italian, B, I'm a pasta maker, and See, my parents are bread makers.
Oh my gosh.
So for me, it was an impossible task from the start.
Now, I know what you're saying. Like, you don't say that lightly. When you say it was an impossible task, you don't say it lightly, because I remember when I was told by an awesome naturopath here in Melbourne, I was told to go gluten-free. Mm-hmm. It was kind of like you're testing my history, my lineage, my life for every single day of my life until the age of 37. You're questioning my identity. Like, what do you mean go gluten-free? Does that mean I don't get to eat bread? What am I going to eat instead?
Yeah.
And there was this idea in my mind that if I'm not eating bread, that there's some weird part of my life missing, because when I go to my mum's house, or any relative's house, there's a pile of bread on the table all the time, and you're supposed to slap everything on it, you know, whether it's whether you're making a little tomato beautiful thing, you know, with oregano and olive oil, or putting butter on there, or whether you're putting cheese on there, it doesn't matter, it goes with everything. Whether you're wiping up the sauce from the pasta, it doesn't matter, bread goes with every single thing, right? And it was a really difficult thing for me to comprehend, not only to actually take action on what she said, but to actually comprehend what that meant.
Yeah.
What do you mean I've got to stop eating? What does that actually mean for my life? And then I would go to my parents' house and they would say, why aren't you eating bread? Here, have some bread. And I'd say,
because the natural. As you do with any European family.
The nutritionist told me not to. What do you mean the nutritionist told you not to? What the hell does that mean? And that was really difficult. So I imagine for you it was at least 3 or 4 or 100 times harder.
It was being in business and also the fact that I eat pasta every day. You know, I've been making pasta for 26 years and I am not sick of it. I enjoy eating pasta. I've got my favorites and I'll stick to those, but we don't go a day at the table without eating pasta, whether it's in a minestrone or made with a bolognese sauce or a ravioli or a tortellini or a gnocchi of some sort. So there's always pasta on my dinner table. But what I've learned is to manage the portions. So I'm not a big pasta eater. Like, you know, when I was single, I lived at home with my mum. The plates would be so full that they'd be overflowing. And you'd have to be careful with the fork because you'd spill the pasta on the outside of the plate. But at home, I'll probably have four or five ravioli. And Antoinette usually cooks a protein, so some meat or some chicken, even some fish. So I balance it out now.
Yeah, I know. I remember those going home to my mum's place and just having a bowl of spaghetti with a beautiful sauce and then half a loaf of bread to wipe up the sauce. I mean, and it was delicious. It was everything that you could ever wish for, you know. But
It's heaven.
Yeah. And then you associate that deliciousness, that love, that connection with your mom and your family, all that gets associated to this bowl of food.
Yeah.
And it's more than a conversation about we need to stop eating carbs. We need to find a new way to relate to our family and our friends and our loved ones when we're told to stop eating bread or stop eating pasta.
That's right.
So it's a real complex situation. So you're the stereotypical Italian guy. When people from a Greek background like me teased an Italian guy in the schoolyard, you know, when we were growing up, I used to say, go eat a bowl of pasta, mate. And then the Italian guys would say to me, go eat a souvlaki.
Yeah.
And we were supposed to be doing that to give people a hard time. But the truth is, eating a souvlaki is amazing. Eating a bowl of pasta was amazing. It was hardly a way to give somebody a hard time.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's part of our diet. And I mean, going back to diabetes, look, it is one of the most manageable diseases. And you don't know how many people get it wrong, myself included. I think it has a lot to do with complacency, you know, day-to-day life. But the great thing about the disease is there are a lot of technological advances these days. So they make measuring sugar a lot easier. So I've got a device that is on my arm that I wave my phone over and it will tell me what my sugar is at any one time. So I can give myself the amount of insulin that I need. And the great thing is it keeps a history. So if my doctor needs to see what my sugars are like, he or she can log into my account and observe the results. So there are advancements, you know, delivery of insulin these days, especially for type 1 diabetics. They Diabetes New South Wales give devices to automatically deliver insulin into your body when you need it. You just tell them the amount and you don't have to jab yourself with a needle. So management of diabetes has come a long way.
Tell me about the device that's on your hand, because I have seen them before and I know you attach it for a little bit of time. So it's there for quite a time and then you replace it every so often. Tell me about the whole process to that.
Well, the device isn't cheap for starters. It's a $99 sensor and it only lasts for 2 weeks. There is a fine wire that sits under the skin that's in contact with blood 24/7. It only keeps results for 2 weeks. It expires after 2 weeks, so you do need to have another one replaced. The great thing about our country is that we have the NDIS. Now, because I have a disability and I can't use my right hand to measure my sugar properly, I get this device as... I've got it's called, but it'll come to me in a second. But it's an aid to assist people that have disability, and the NDIS pays for it.
Yeah, the National Disability Insurance Scheme. Yeah. So that's a pretty cool thing. And when you wave your phone over, it's connected to an app?
It is on my phone. I've got the app that comes with the sensor, and it gives me a graph of how my sugars are going. Little lights will turn red if my sugars are too high or too low. It just gives the history so that the doctors can see how I'm going with my diabetes.
Seeing that data real time for you, is that really helpful for you to know, okay, swallow the pill, take the insulin? Is that better than what it was way back whenever you were being slack?
It's funny how things change post-stroke because you do pay more attention to your health. As I mentioned, you know, there was some complacency there, but after my stroke, I was told that, you know, I could have another stroke if I continue with the course of action that I'm taking at the moment with not looking after my sugar. So I measure my sugar 3 to 4 times a day. I take my insulin, I take my tablets. So nothing is skipped these days. So I plan to live for a very long time.
Yeah, good to hear, man. And doing that now doesn't really interfere into your life, because you can measure your sugar anywhere. You can give yourself insulin anywhere. You can. There's no place where you can't do it, for example, is there?
Anywhere I want. And that was part of the reasoning behind the National Disability Insurance Scheme giving the device to me, because I can't measure my sugar, say, standing up because I've got balance problems. I'm not able to use my hand properly. So all these reasons was for this device for me to wear.
Yeah, to make it easy. Awesome.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit about, I'm going to take you into that place a little bit about the day that it happened and then after that, because I want to get a feeling for what you guys were going through and whether you were cognitively affected or whether you were completely aware of what was happening to you. Mm-hmm. How did the day play out? You started to feel unwell, then you went to hospital.
Yeah.
And then what happened after that?
Well, I didn't know I was having a stroke. So all the usual stuff like facial droop, it wasn't happening. So I walked into hospital. It was only when I sat down that everybody was rushing. The nurses knew what was going on, but I wasn't aware. I started to lose movement in my right arm. It just felt heavy. It's not that I lost control of it. It just started to feel real heavy. I had what you call a progressive stroke. So it didn't happen all at once. It happened between 3 and 4 days. The third day was the worst. So after I was taken into emergency, they didn't make it a stroke call. My stroke was in the brainstem. So it wasn't able to be picked up on a CT scan. So for days, they didn't know whereabouts. They had an idea that it wasn't on the CT scan and that perhaps it might be on the brainstem. So they did an MRI scan. This was after I became paralyzed. I was totally paralyzed on one side. They took me down to the MRI machine with great difficulty. I suffered from claustrophobia. So that was question number one that they asked me. So I kindly asked them for a blindfold and they put me into the machine for quite a while and then they found where the stroke had occurred in the pons area of the brain. So paralyzed on one side and then complications with look, I think it's called bradycardia.
Bradycardia.
Yep, and that's
low heart rate.
Yeah. So because I'd severed quite a few nerves going around my body, my brain wasn't making contact with my heart. So, I was quite fortunate because the first time it happened to me, I had a doctor in front of me. I had my wife to one side. I was in bed in a ward, and doctor was in front of me. And I started to explain to the doctor that I was feeling a little queasy. I felt like I was going to pass out. And he said, look, it's not a problem. You're in a bed. Nothing's going to happen to you. Within a matter of seconds, I closed my eyes. I thought I'd reopen them, but I was out for a little while. The scene had changed for me. My wife wasn't beside me anymore. I had a bunch of doctors and nurses around me. Somebody had hit the emergency button. I think it was Dr. Colin that did. And when I did open my eyes, I think he looked more pale than me because he was a training doctor and a lovely, lovely guy too. I felt so sorry for him when I did wake up because I thought I'd just close my eyes and open them, and he goes, no, Joe, you were out for a while. So they took me down to ICU after that. It did happen several times in ICU. So they decided to put a PICC line in my arm and start delivering, it'll come to me, adrenaline and isoprenaline. And as my heart rate came down, the nurses would pump up the adrenaline for me to keep my heart rate up. The great thing about where I was situated in ICU was there was near the desk where all the doctors and nurses were at. So if I wanted to grab their attention, I could, and I did. And I remember one occasion.
If you've had a stroke and you're in recovery, you'll know what a scary and confusing time it can be. You're likely to have a lot of questions going through your mind. Like, how long will it take to recover? Will I actually recover? What things should I avoid in case I make matters worse? Doctors will explain things, but obviously you've never had a stroke before. You probably don't know what questions to ask. If this is you, you may be missing out on doing things that could help speed up your recovery. If you're finding yourself in that situation, stop worrying and head to recoveryafterstroke.com, where you can download a guide that will help you. It's called 7 Questions to Ask Your Doctor About Your Stroke. These 7 questions are the ones Bill wished he'd asked when he was recovering from a stroke. They'll not only help you better understand your condition, they'll help you take a more active role in your recovery. Head to the website now, recoveryafterstroke.com, and download the guide. It's free.
This doctor called Dr. Charles, I called him over and I said, I feel like I'm going to pass out again. And he was looking up at the machine. I was hooked up to wires to a machine there. And he said to me, Joe, your numbers look fine. Rest. And within a matter of seconds, I crashed again. So the doctors knew. It was actually quite odd for them to have a conscious patient telling them that I was going to pass out. So as the doctors did gather around, I remember Dr. Charles saying to all the other nurses and doctors, if Joe tells you that he's going to pass out, believe him because he'll tell you before the machines do.
Man, that is absolutely nuts. So was that traumatic for you? And
it was.
What was happening every time you were opening your eyes again? How did that make you feel? What were you thinking about? What were you worried about?
To tell you the truth, I thought I was going to die. A lot of people beside me in beds. I was in an area in the neurological section, so I had a priest on one side of the bed giving somebody the last rites. Another guy in the other side of the bed had to have his skull opened So I felt I was going to die. I really thought I was going to die. But by the grace of God, I'm still here. Today. It changed me. I was already a happy-go-lucky guy before the stroke. But I think my son put it really well when he said, "Dad, after your stroke, you grew a personality."
Wow.
So, I didn't know whether to take offense to it. But look, I was even more of a clown after the stroke. In fact, look, it was dull in hospital. It was really boring. And people knew who I was. So I'd spoken to people about my business. The nurses, they said, "We want to come down and buy a pasta." So I'd be entertaining them at night and telling them jokes when I really should have been resting. So it was great that I had that, and the nurses and doctors were great. I don't recommend having a stroke to anybody. They're overrated. So definitely look after your health. Because you only get one chance at it.
I know what you're saying about the blessing of having your ability to make a joke and laugh and talk to people and all of that. I know a lot of stroke survivors in the early part of their recovery, they don't have that, because they're out of it. And I was out of it a couple of times because I had 3 bleeds and then I had surgery. For the second bleed, it was pretty dramatic. It's the one that took away my ability to remember things and who came to visit me and my wife's name and my ability to drive and work and all that kind of stuff. The first bleed was just created numbness on my left side. So I was able to talk exactly as I am now, even walk and move. It was all fine. Mm-hmm. And the third bleed basically created more of the numbness. And then the surgery created the ability for me not to walk again. And then I had to learn how to walk again and use my arm again. But it was only the second bleed that took away my personality and my ability to be me.
Yeah.
Whereas the other ones didn't. And that contrast later, I think, made it easier for my family and friends when they come to visit.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, he's still a smart ass. Oh, we still had a chat. You know, all that stuff was still there and that was good for them.
Yeah.
So what's your wife going through? And has she given you some information about what the experience was like for her?
Well, she was fortunate to be able to film some of my time in ICU. So I look at the video clips and the way I spoke because my speech was greatly affected. So I've come a long way from sitting in ICU for 2 weeks, not moving, to now where people have to tell me to sit down and shut up. So it's a big difference. She was scared. I scared a lot of people, myself included. Scars, yeah, there are a lot of scars, but they're not physical scars.
Yeah.
They're more mental scars. I have problems with my memory, and I need to be able to have a good memory at work. And I know I suffer a lot with my short-term memory. Sometimes I don't get my words out right. I had to do speech therapy for saying a few words. And I needed to be able to greet somebody on the phone at work. So it was, "Good morning, Peps Pastor. Good afternoon, Peps Pastor." And getting the 2 words with the P's was a struggle for me. So I did have a rehab center that did some speech therapy with me. But thank God, you know, I improved. So I can speak well, I'm clear, and I do tend to forget words and I get unstuck there because it becomes frustrating. because I don't remember the word that I want to say. That for me is a struggle. The physical struggles, answering your phone and writing down an order. The great thing that the NDIS did is giving an earphone. So it frees my left hand to be able to speak to customers on the phone and take orders down. I've gone a little backwards when it's come to what I can and can't do, but that is because of my hand. Making pasta is a physical thing. So to be able to pull ravioli off the machine or to pull fettuccine off the machine is a struggle for me. But the great thing about my business is that I have trained staff there. So I spent nearly 3 months in the hospital and, you know, the guys at work, my head pasta maker, my administration lady, they just took over the business and treated it like their own. So I was just concentrating on recovering. Antoinette went into work maybe a few days a week, but she spent most of the time with me in hospital. So it's great that I have those people there that can do those things. So now I do a lot of nothing upstairs in the office, in an air-conditioned office.
Playing solitaire?
Not quite. But I answer phones. I do some data entry. So I've had to change the way I work. But I know one day I'll be paying for it. If my hand doesn't improve, and I am making improvements in my hand, I attend rehab twice a week and I do physiotherapy once a week. So I'm very active on my rehab, and over the past few months I've been able to do things that I haven't been able to do in the past. Simple things like using knife or being able to move my wrist, being able to lift my arm and lift my wrist up, open and close my fingers. And again, it's all thanks to technology determination. There's a little device that I was given in hospital, and I was one of the first people in rehab to use it. It's called the Sato glove.
I interviewed the guys that make the Sato glove.
You do?
Yeah.
You'll have to thank them for me, because I believe a lot of my recovery was because of that device, because of the chains attached to my fingers. It helped me to open my hand, so I was picking up balls and releasing them into a bucket, and that was a part of my therapy day in, day out. The great thing about it was that when I was released from the rehab hospital, I went straight into the public system, and there's a, I think it's called Stroke Outreach at Royal Prince Alfred, mm-hmm. and they also bought the device. So I continued my therapy at Royal Prince Alfred. It was great to have that continuation, as well as doing task-specific types of things, like, as I said, using the knife.
Brilliant, man. You talk about earlier, you talked a little bit about the mental scars.
Mm-hmm.
Is there emotional scars?
Very much so. So I find it hard sometimes to use the right emotions. So an example, I'm at a funeral, I'd be having a smile on my face because I can't control that smile. If I'm having an argument with someone, I'm laughing or smiling, and it's the wrong use of emotion, but it's something that I cannot control. So I annoy people when I argue with them, and I'm smiling while I'm arguing with them. So they get mixed signals, and that's frustrating, because I managed to piss them off instead.
Wow. So that is that something, Joe, you were able to be angry before in an argument, and you were able to be sad at a funeral. Like,
yeah,
that's new to you. This is like a, is it like a switcheroo of your emotions?
Oh, totally. Like movies, sad movies, I cry.
Yeah.
Sad movies. Okay. And I never used to before the stroke. I'd be the tough one in the family. And, you know, my boys and Antoinette would be crying at any sad movie. So now I'm crying. I cry at movies.
But you laugh at a funeral or you smile at a funeral. What's that?
Yeah. It's because I can't switch off that facial signal. That smile or the emotion. So I'm not sure what it is, but it's a bag of mixed emotions. I cry at work. I never cry at work. Before.
What do you cry over? Because I cried, and still do. For me, it's nearly been. Next year will be 9 years. February will be 9 years since the first bleed. So, what do you cry about?
I cry that I see people using two hands on a keyboard, and I remember I was a mad typist. I mean, it wasn't spectacular, but it was 35 words a minute. I cry at that. I cry that I see my staff manning a pasta machine, and I can't. One serving customers in the shop. To open a plastic bag and to put product in it for me was a struggle, and I'm getting better. But that made me sad.
Yeah.
I suppose the worst was you're probably not going to like me for this, but I spent 3 months in hospital, so I wanted to get out. So I decided with my family and I, we're going to Italy. 2 weeks after getting out of hospital, I'd already spent 3 months in hospital against doctor's orders. The reason why I had to travel was to buy a new pasta machine, although in hindsight, it would be better to keep the old one because the old one was slower and I could manage it a lot better. So this new fettuccine machine does 150 kilos per hour. So I went to Italy, spent a couple of weeks there. I actually got the best rehab in Italy. So walking the streets of Rome, there's cobblestones. And because I have some issues, had some issues with my dorsiflexion, having the cobblestones there made me lift my foot higher. So I got better quicker and I did some steps while I was walking the streets of Rome. But the reason why I say that is because the machine is now here in Australia in my pasta factory. We're operating it and it's a beautiful machine, but I can't use it and that makes me sad.
Yeah, it was a good reason to go overseas though. When I was in Rome after my own stroke, but it probably took me about 5 years to get there, about a year after my surgery. We did all those cobblestone streets and we walked for 10 hours a day.
Yeah.
And like you, man, it was really good rehab because it built my stamina and my fitness up back. And really gently, while I was being distracted by these beautiful things in Rome. And I suppose I had the same opportunity in Melbourne in Australia, but I didn't do that here. I just stayed at home here for some weird reason. But of course, when you're in Rome, there's no you're silly to be in Rome and go nowhere and do nothing.
You want to be out and see things.
Yeah. So, and there's only one way to see it, and that's by walking. There's no point driving anywhere.
Yeah.
So we did exactly the same thing. So, I really appreciate what you said about being in a different place and then using that different place as a reason to have real subtle therapy.
Yeah,
and experience culture difference and all that type of thing. And I'm not saying that you have to travel like you and I do. I don't know how many thousands of miles is it to get to one entire day.
We were originally supposed to go to Canberra, That was the discussion. I remember we were sitting as a family in a Chinese restaurant, fresh out of hospital, and I'm saying to my wife, I've been in hospital too long. Let's go to Canberra. And from that discussion, it went straight to Italy. And I kid you not, my wife and I, within 2 days of deciding, were on a plane with my sons over to Italy. That's how knee-jerk reaction it was for us. 2 days and we're on a plane.
Man, that's cool. I know that a lot of people can't do that, but from the point of view of, you know, how can we make this story useful for other people that have had a stroke, just go to another state that takes you an hour to get to or 2 hours to get to, and use it as an opportunity to learn something new if you can and find a way to get there, even if you're in an electric scooter, even if, you know, you're not totally mobile, do something somewhere else where your brain is preoccupied with amazing things and you're not paying attention to the rehabilitation. It's such a great way to do it. And I wouldn't recommend traveling 16,000 kilometers or 9,950 miles.
Did you just Google that?
Yeah. But,
wow. Well,
but we did.
Yeah. And it's the best distraction. You know, you can either sit at home, and I could have, you know, I was fresh out of hospital. I remember the first few days feeling sorry for myself about, you know, what had happened to me. I still wasn't walking properly. I wasn't confident in leaving the hospital. In fact, I was one of the very few that would have preferred to stay in rehab a bit more. Yeah. But I still had the gait belt on and they wheelchaired me onto a plane. But instead of feeling sorry for myself at home, I was out seeing the world because I wasn't stuck at home sitting watching TV. You know, I was walking, and that contributes a lot to me getting better. Yeah. And you know, I want to make 100% recovery. I know it's been 2 years already, and there's been lots of recovery, but I want to get back to normal. I want to be 100%.
Yeah, why not, man? That's a great thing to aim for. I know that some people get frustrated with that term, that I'm going to be 100%, but I can't use my arm or I can't use my leg. So for me, I can't feel my left side the same as I used to. It's never going to change. When I get fatigued, it always goes to sleep before my right side. It always, it means that when it gets fatigued, I bump into the doorway on the left. It means all sorts of things, but I am healthier now than I have ever been. I feel like I am 100%, even though I have this ongoing feeling on my left side and fatigue.
Yeah.
Fatigue maybe at the end of the day after a really long day or after a really hot day and maybe I haven't hydrated properly. But I'm 100%. And people find that strange because
they do.
That's what I say to them. I am. That doesn't mean that my leg works perfectly or my arm works perfectly. It just means that I'm 100% healthy and back to normal. And I do what I can do. And my body has a really good way of reminding me I've done too much. It says, we can't do anymore. Your left side's going to go weak now and you need to sit down and you need to rest. And that is a tool that I never had before. Do you do you listen to your body now? Does it give you a lot of signals?
I do. I see it. I feel it. Unfortunately, others don't. So by 7 o'clock, you know, I'd be feeling really tired.
Yeah.
I'd feel fatigued. I'd lose my balance. So, you know, people don't see fatigue. And that's the one sad thing because fatigue plagues me. It plays with my balance. You know, I run into walls and I hurt myself, I don't believe. I've got a lot of scratches on my feet, on my arm, because I feel tired in the afternoon and all I want to do is sleep. There is medication for it, and although it does help me, I find that when the medication wears off, I get this feeling of anxiety. So I don't particularly like to take it unless I really need to. And that's the drug called modafinil. I've used that to keep me alert in when I've had to be awake for longer than normal. But these days, I'm in bed by 9 o'clock at night. And people wonder, why is he going to bed so early? And it's because the fatigue that, you know, obviously they don't see, but I feel, because I can't walk properly, I lose my balance. I've fallen over a few times because I'm that tired that I won't move my foot properly. So that is a problem for me.
Yeah, it does get better. Fatigue does get better. One of the things that you'll find is that it's similar to a muscle. The more you push it and go over the limit, the more it comes, you become better at it.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that you should push it and crash to the point of no return, because sometimes I used to push it and fatigue would take me a day or two to overcome back then, you know.
Yeah.
Whereas now, if I just go and have a good sleep, then I'm fine. And I'm in bed even 9 years after stroke. If I wake up at 6:30 or 7 o'clock in the morning, some days I can be in bed by 9:30, 10 o'clock, because I just, the body's shutting, the brain's shutting down, and I just need to rest it.
Yeah.
And it takes a while, but people get used to you being in bed a bit earlier. It takes a while.
I'm not quite there yet. The other issue I have, I mean, living so close to work, I do get tired quite easily. So midday, 1 o'clock, I might come home and call it a day. And I'll go to bed for an hour or so, wake up and feel refreshed and tackle the afternoon.
It sounds like the business could run completely without you, though. You need to be there for other reasons other than just because there's an order coming through, right? It just seems like there's more to it for you than just selling pasta. So,
it is. I mean, I'm attached to my business. It's I began the business in 1993, but I've also had a major shift in that I wouldn't mind retiring. And the only thing that's stopping me from retiring is income. But given the opportunity, I would consider selling my business. I have a hobby at home that I thought I would never, ever take up, and that's gardening. I was a hopeless gardener. I didn't have a green thumb. And that would be to my father's disgust, because he grows veggies in his backyard. He's got tomato growing, broad beans, he's got the basil growing, and I don't grow things, but I've taken on succulents. And guess what? It's good therapy. Potting, moving plants around, watering, taking weeds out. So I'm learning to keep my balance and to use my hands to plant into pots.
You'll probably sell the pasta business and then turn your hobby into a succulent business.
How did you guess? Yeah, I definitely would do that.
It's written all over your face, man. I could see it.
What is it? Is it the commercialist in me? I mean, the entrepreneur in me?
It's just, you don't do anything by halves. I know exactly the type of guy you are. I'm a similar kind of guy, you know. I'm looking at, I do a podcast.
I'm young. I mean, I'm 51. You know, I can't be sitting around. My dad was 83 before he retired and sold the bakery. It kept him healthy. And I was having this discussion with a friend of mine yesterday that being active, even playing crosswords or or reading a book, it keeps the mind active. So I want to keep active.
The last few weeks and month or so, so we're recording this in mid-December 2020. Mm-hmm. The last in Victoria, in Australia, you know, we've had a really tough time, and being at home doing nothing because of the coronavirus for the best part of 6 months has been really tough on people. And it really paints a picture of what life would be like for me if I had nothing to do all day, every day, if I was at home doing nothing and had no hobbies and no passions and all that kind of thing. And one of my, and somebody passed away about a month and a half ago, and she was my counselor that I'd been seeing for 20 years. So we had moved beyond the relationship of counselor. I go there to be fixed by my counselor for my issues, you know, in my head. It was like that person, that wise woman that you go to for lifelong advice, that she's been on the planet for a long time and she knows things to teach me to pass down to my kids, you know. That was the kind of relationship we had. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I was never able to find out, Joe, in the time that I saw her, was her age, because it's rude to ask some women their age. And I asked her once and she shut me down. Unfortunately, when she passed away, I discovered her age. And that was at the funeral. She was 82 years old and still working as a psychologist in her practice every day, helping people. And for me, that was so inspiring to hear that she, regardless of her ill health or the issues that she had, she rocked up to work every single day, and it kept her healthier and living longer than if she had just stayed at home doing nothing, waiting for the illnesses to go away or whatever it was, you know. Mm-hmm. So hearing your dad's story is similar to me. It's that perhaps it had moved on for your dad. It had gone beyond being about making money and all that kind of stuff. It became about a passion. It became about meeting people and seeing people and giving them their bread and having conversations. And your succulent business is going to become that for you, you know. It's going to be the thing that you do that's not really about money. It's about passion and a process that you've got to get through to get to an end point. And the end point is whatever you want it to be. It's actually, the succulent is just the thing that gets the job done to get you feeling a certain way. Now, I'm being cheeky and saying that you're going to turn it. But you know what I mean. For me, I don't see myself as ever retiring from anything. If I'm not doing the physical work, I'm like you. I'm going to find a bolt to sell or something to somebody just for the sake of selling it, not for any other reason.
That's right. I think it's in our blood. I mean, I've been very fortunate that I've had staff work with me for so long that they know how to run the business. That was one of the first thing I learned in business was to be able to put people in positions where they decide how things go and give them the power to make the decisions. So I can pick up and I can walk away, but the thing is, I don't want to, because, you know, there's a 400 meter walk to work. That does me the world of good.
Yeah.
There's a flight of 20 stairs that I've got to walk up to go into my office. That does me the world of good. So talking to people, having lunch with people, communicating, living normal life, I don't think I could stay at home. You know, I live in I live in the inner west here in Sydney. There are a lot of cafes. Friends stop by at work. They come and see me. They'll take me out for a coffee. Yeah. And I enjoy that. It's not like it's pressuring me. I'm at that point in my life where I don't need to grow the business. I can keep at this pace. So I'm happy to continue at this pace for a little bit longer.
Yeah, sounds like a good thing to do, man. Tell me about the pasta. If people wanted to buy your pasta, where would they go?
Well, if you live in Sydney. We're in a beautiful Federation suburb called Haberfield, and the business is called Pep's Pasta, and we're on Ramsey Street in Haberfield. We've been there a very long time. We've won a few awards, as you can see. So we enter the Royal Agricultural Society Spine Food Show every year. Last year, we were fortunate enough to get a gold medal and also the most successful exhibitor at the show. So we're really proud of that. So it's a quality product. I do have to say, COVID really hasn't affected us. There was a problem with supermarkets running out of pasta. And we do have a couple of supermarkets around us. So a lot of customers spilled into our store and began buying our fresh pasta. They liked it and they're now continually buying it. So we haven't, I know a lot of businesses have. Pasta hasn't been one of those businesses.
That have struggled, huh? You guys are selling staples and people want to eat pasta to feel better during a lockdown because pasta really makes you feel warm in the heart and all that type of thing.
It does. And, you know, a lot of people did take up pasta making and bread making at home.
Yeah.
Bread making is not so difficult, but try to make a gnocchi. If you get the consistency wrong, you may as well throw the whole batch of potatoes out. So people do try it, and then they give up and say, I'll go to Pepe's and go grab some ricotta gnocchi or some potato gnocchi. So,
If you're not a grandmother, you know, who's been making it for 57 years, you've probably got no hope of making gnocchi, really. If
you're
looking over your shoulder, it's going to be a struggle, isn't it?
It took me a very long time, and I'm a pasta maker.
Yeah. So you guys are on Instagram and Facebook and all that kind of stuff. Where will people find you?
So if you look up Pepe's Pasta, that's P-E-P-P-E-S Pasta. You'll find us on Facebook. Same for Instagram. You can call us. The numbers are on our pages. We look one of our most popular products is the lasagna, and we can't make enough of them. We do a family-sized lasagna, and it helps people that don't want to cook. So, and it is a very, very nice lasagna.
Yeah, and do you sell online?
We're currently doing our website, so that should be up in the next week. We're finalising some photography this week. Hopefully by Friday it will all be done. But people can get in contact with us through our Facebook, Instagram.
Yeah, brilliant, mate. Joe, it's been a real pleasure getting to meet you and getting to know you and learning a little bit about your story. I'm so glad you reached out. I really connected with you when you sent me that first Facebook message, and I thought this is a guy that we definitely have to have on the podcast. And now that lockdown is over and I love coming to Sydney, I am definitely going to come past and have a plate of pasta with you, even though I'm gluten-free.
You are more than welcome, and I guarantee you will not be leaving empty-handed. We have a little saying, and I say this in my dialect, "Kumia non si more mai di fame," which means, with me, you'll never go hungry.
I look forward to it, man. Thank you so much for being on the podcast.
My pleasure, Bill. Thank you so much.
Discover how to heal your brain after stroke. Go to recoveryafterstroke.com. Importantly, we present many podcasts designed to give you an insight and understanding into the experiences of other individuals. Opinions and treatment protocols discussed during any podcast are the individual's own experience, and we do not necessarily share the same opinion, nor do we recommend any treatment protocol discussed. All content on this website and any linked blog, podcast, or video material controlled this website or content is created and produced for informational purposes only and is largely based on the personal experience of Bill Gassiamis. The content is intended to complement your medical treatment and support healing. It is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice and should not be relied on as health advice. The information is general and may not be suitable for your personal injuries, circumstances, or health objectives. Do not use our content as a standalone resource to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease for therapeutic purposes or as a substitute for the advice of a health professional. Never delay seeking advice or disregard the advice of a medical professional, your doctor, or your rehabilitation program based on our content. If you have any questions or concerns about your health or medical condition, please seek guidance from a doctor or other medical professional. If you are experiencing a health emergency or think you might be, call 000 if in Australia or your local emergency number immediately for emergency assistance or go to the nearest hospital emergency department. Medical information changes constantly. While we aim to provide current quality information in our content, we do not provide any guarantees and assume no legal liability or responsibility for the accuracy, currency, or completeness of the content. If you choose to rely on any information within our content, you do so solely at your own risk. We are careful with links we provide. However, third-party links from our website are followed at your own risk, and we are not responsible for any information you find there.